Yeah, now we will get some more information. We saw it in the two last days, something about Kubernetes operators. We saw Quark was with building applications for Kubernetes, but now we will see hopefully some group pipeline actions, how we could deploy our applications or making continuous integration for applications. Nico will show us some insight with GitLab. So please give Nico a warm welcome, and the next talk will also begin now.
Thank you. So, hey everyone. So, I'm Nico Meisenthal. I'm a consultant at Vitag and doing any kind of stuff around container, Kubernetes, CI/CD, automation, pipelining, and so on. And sometimes translating between development and operations. The agenda for the next 35, 45 minutes. First of all, I would like to talk about containerized pipelines and why you should think about using them. And then we're doing some information on how to build those pipelines and how to run your containerized pipelines in a Kubernetes cluster. We're doing it with GitLab CI/CD. Then we'll see things around how to build Docker images or container images in a container, because we are building containerized pipelines, so we need to build our images in container. With a tool, open source project called Kaniko. And then the last part, we have a look at Tecton, which is a cloud native pipeline solution, which completely shifts your whole pipeline into Kubernetes. Not only the workload, also the configuration. Yeah, so let's start over. Why you should use containerized pipelines? Basically, it's the same reason why you should use containers at all. So you have a better isolation, thinking about different jobs you're running on your build agents with dependencies, different versions, different Java versions, .NET Core versions, and so on. You can just isolate your build processes. They're running in container. So it's totally fine to build different dependencies on the same node. And of course, dependencies we are building in a container image, which we can describe. So we have our Docker file where we can list all of our dependencies and the exact versions we would like to use them, and therefore can be sure that the dependencies are met and are exactly the versions we would like to get. If you're thinking about multiple build nodes, which might not be created or updated with infrastructure as code, they're pretty sure they are not completely identical, and you have small version changes between the builders. So it's nice to have it in a container. And just get the same environment all the time. Of course, it's also scalability. It's pretty nice if you're running your build nodes on Kubernetes. You can just scale them up and down as you need them. And then, of course, immutability, which basically means every job you're starting is based on the Docker file or a Docker image, so it's exactly the same environment all the time you're building your code. Yeah, and as example, doesn't matter which version you would like to build or which tools you're based on, you can put every of your jobs on one compute power and just build it. And it works with everything. Node.js, .NET Core, Go, and of course Terraform, Ansible, and all other tools or tool sets you would like to use. Yeah, so let's talk about a pipeline job image. So as I already said, you need to put everything you would like to use in that pipeline job into your container image. And I would recommend you to really build different container images for every build job you would like to have. So I don't know, if you would like to lint the YAML file, just put in your YAML lint. If you like to deploy something with Terraform, just build a Docker container with Terraform in it, and not building big containers with all your tool sets and reusing them all the time. So just put in the stuff you need. Fix the dependencies and the version of the tool that you would like to use, that you can make sure that you use the same environment all the time. And of course, also rebuild your container build images. So thinking about security fixes and so on. And thing which we will have if we're building containers, you need to think about how you can speed up your deployment. So we need to think about caching and stuff like this, because you always run your build in a new instance, so you don't have caching and so on. So it's something you will need to fix to speed up your deployment. And I will show you an example how you can do it. Yeah, so this is just an example for a small Docker file. I think it's nothing special, so we just base it on hello. Oh, it's working wonderful. Okay, I will walk. So it's based on Alpine latest tech. Don't use it in production. Just some information. Then I'm using an environment variable to fix my to set my version for YAMLint, and just then install it, define an entry point, and then I can use this Docker file, and it's pretty basic to do YAMLint and so on. So really simple examples in my demos, and just to give you the basics. Yeah, so then we need to run our container image somehow. Though we have different options. First one is we are using our CI/CD tool and just installing a Docker daemon or any other daemon or tool which can run and start and manage container instances. And then just do a CI job, Docker run, blah, 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 to start your image, which is somehow fine. You will get your tasks running in a container, but then you need to fix things like uploading artifacts within my container somewhere else. You need to mount volumes to get caching and stuff like this. So it's you need to fix manually things to get it really, really nice. And there's where GitLab comes in. Pretty nice solution, which is called GitLab Runner Kubernetes Executor, which is basically just a GitLab runner as we know it, which is designed to run in Kubernetes. This is the first step. And the second one is to also run the container images in Kubernetes as pods, as you need them. So it's pretty nice. Yeah, it integrates your CI/CD with Kubernetes and schedules your workload as a pod in your Kubernetes cluster. Which then, of course, allows you to share compute, so you don't need build host or multiple build hosts. You just can put it on dedicated nodes in a Kubernetes cluster, or also share the nodes with other workloads. So it's pretty nice. Yeah, some more details on the GitHub runner part. The GitHub runner itself runs within the Kubernetes cluster, so you can deploy it from the GitHub UI. But I would recommend you to use a Helm deployment and maybe automate this for updates, etc., with the pipeline. And then if a job needs to be scheduled, the Kubernetes executor talks to the Kubernetes API and just schedules a pod for this a task we would like to run. And the pod contains our image we defined, so let's say the YAMLint image I had, but it also creates some other, let's call it service containers, which are doing stuff like caching, artifact management, and so things for me. So it's the build step is divided in multiple steps. So we have the prepare step, which basically just creates the pod with all the containers. Then we have the pre-build step, where GitLab automatically clones the repo in my container, restores caching, downloads artifacts if we need them, and then the actual build step starts. And this is the part we're defining. So our build steps, our container image, and so on. And if this job is finished, we get to the post-build step, but then GitLab again uploads the caches, uploads artifacts, and so on. So it's completely managed. You don't need to care about it. Just define it in your pipeline configuration in the YAML, and you are able to use it. So how does it look in action? So I have a demo project to show you the stuff live, and I hope it works. So first of all, you need to link your Kubernetes cluster with GitLab. You can do it on a project-based level, but you can also define it on a group. Which is pretty nice, and then you can just define a Kubernetes cluster for one group and then reuse it in multiple pipelines and projects. So basically, it's just adding your Kubernetes cluster, secrets and stuff like this, the API URL, secret, service token, and so on, and save it. And then you have the option, as shown here, to install the GitHub runner, which is pretty nice, but nothing for production. So for production, I would use the Helm chart, build a pipeline, and so on. But for a demo, it's totally fine to install it via the UI. With this in place, we then get in our settings CI/CD in the runner sections a new runner because we just installed the runner on our Kubernetes. And here it's online, and it's tagged with the cluster tag, which is default, and Kubernetes, which is also default. And then when we go to our YAML definition for CI/CD, you can link the tag in the YAML definition and then make sure that the pipeline is started on this runner. On the Kubernetes side, we can check out the ports. And it's basically, in this demo, it's just one instance for the runner, so it's just this pod. It's just running and waiting for jobs to schedule. Okay, so let's have a look at the demos. So we have a pretty basic CI pipeline. Doesn't matter at all. So we have one stage, we have a deploy step. I have some variables defining my image for the job. In this case, it's a demo image, which is providing Helm CLI. Some other information which I will use for the deployment. And then we have our job. Once again, it's tagged with Kubernetes, which will force GitLab to schedule it on the Kubernetes runner. We will provide an image name. And in this case, I'm overwriting the entry point from the image and providing the steps from my pipeline as script. And in this case, it doesn't matter at all. It's just a sample application, and I'm doing a Helm upgrade, providing some informations. So to show you, it's basically our sample application. This is Fred. And now we can do a short CI/CD run and changing some text here. So if we run pipeline, and I've defined a variable to update the message. And wait, we will do, it was already. And we will run the pipeline. And then move back to kubectl. We are seeing that a pod is created, which is scheduled. We have two containers in it. One is the Helm container image I defined, and the other one is the service container, which is doing caching, artifact uplogging, and so on. It was created, and once again, already terminated because the job was done. And then we have the restart of the sample because I did a Helm upgrade, so my sample application gets a new version. And is back online. And if we then can check the logs in CI/CD. Perhaps. So GitLab had a performance issue 2 hours ago. So yeah, so we see the whole steps. It's fetching the Git repos, fetching the submodules I added, and doing the Helm upgrade steps. So it's from the GitLab CI/CD. It's just the default layout. Nothing special. And the pipeline is already finished. Took only some seconds. And now if you go to my sample application, do a reload, we have the updated version. So this is just a simple pipeline, nothing special, but to show you how the whole stuff is working. Okay. So, now we're doing container REST pipelines. So we need containers for our pipeline, and we also would like to build containers for our applications. So we need some solution to build containers in containers. And then there's something called Docker and Docker. I'm not sure somebody using Docker and Docker in CI/CD pipelines. Okay, some of you, I'm not a big fan of it. There's some security issues, some other issues, there are some kind of different solutions. You can exposing the Docker socket in your container. You can start mounting the Docker directory within your container, or even using or starting privileged container and really running the Docker daemon in your container. It's fine if you do so, but if you're trying to run CI/CD in a Kubernetes cluster, which is somehow production, or at least in a production environment, even if it's a building cluster or dev cluster, I'm pretty sure you are not allowed to run privileged containers or to even mount a local file system with it. So you might get issues. There's where Kaniko come into place. So it's an open source project from Google, which allows you to build containers in containers without the need of any privileges. So I linked the URL to the repo. And then, once again, you still have issues with caching and so on. And Kaniko provides two options to provide caching order to fasten your CI/CD build. You can cache layers, which basically means you can Kaniko will upload the final image as well as layer caching in your registry. In the same one, or you can define a second registry for caching. And for the base image, you can mount a volume in the container if you would like to cache some kind of base images, which you should do, because without that, it's pretty slow, because it's always start to download and download the base image and rebuild every layer. So this is how Kaniko can look like. Of course, you can build Docker images with Kaniko with Docker run. You can schedule this at pod and so on. So it's just basic deployment. So I guess nobody would just deploy a pod, but for demo reasons. So just defining a name, container name, the image. Once again, don't use latest. Providing a Docker file, a context. So in principle, the context is the context root of our project, and then within the context root where the Docker file is located. And then you can define one or multiple destinations. You can even skip destinations, and then you would just build and don't upload the image. With destinations, you can define multiple ones for different tags or different image names or different registries, and then Kaniko will upload them after building them. If you run Kaniko and Kubernetes, you need to make sure that Kaniko is able and authorized to push the images in the registry. So you need to make sure that the service account the pod is running on is allowed to push the images. So once again, a demo. Hey. once again, it's pretty basic one. We have a Docker file, which is the Docker file I used in the last demo. It's just providing Helm. So it's, once again, pretty basic, based on Alpine, based on an image from my side, but it's Alpine-based. Just installing Helm, defining an entry point, so basic stuff. And if you go back, we then have GitLab CI YAML, once again, only one step. A variable defining the Kaniko version. And this one is important. For GitLab CI CD, you need to use the debug image, unfortunately. Because without the default image, you aren't able to execute commands because you do not have a shell in your container. And this doesn't work with GitLab at all. So you need to use the debug parameter to have a shell within your image. And Unfortunately, the debug image is also the latest version. So you don't have a debug image for every version. It's always the latest one. The Kaneko team is aware of this, and they are working on solutions. But at the moment, we only can use the debug image, which is always the latest one. Yeah, once again, we tag it to schedule it in our Kubernetes cluster. We're defining the image with the debug tag, overwriting the entry point. Then we have two lines in the before script, which are basically creating a file for our authentication with our registry. Because I'm pushing the image in the GitLab registry from my project, I can just use the GitLab CI token, which is a one-time token while running my job, and the IHOP token is a secret. So it's pretty secure. It's a one-time token, and I can just use it without defining any kind of secrets and variables and so on. Yeah, and then I have just those lines which are doing the actual work. We're launching the Kaneko executor, providing a context, which is also a default variable. Our project directory, defining the path to our Docker file, and defining the destination, which is once again a default variable because we're using the registry, which is part of our project. So, and if we run this one, basically the same will happen. We run the image. In the background, our job image is scheduled, and if we go back to the output, we're seeing that Kaneko started to download our image. So in this case, I do not enable any kind of caching, and starting to build our image. And it's done. It's a small one. Now if I go to my container registry, I first of all should see a new Helm version, which in this case is tech latest, 27 seconds old. And once again, also this thing I mentioned before, I have the cache layers also in my registry. Which are not new because it was the same image, so there was no new upload. So it's pretty nice. Okay, so one step further, we are now running containerized pipelines. We have shifted the workload from our build machine to our Kubernetes cluster. Don't need any special build nodes anymore. But there's the next step. I'm not sure that someone of you heard about Tecton or already used Tecton. Okay, cool. So Tecton is a pretty new project. It was part of the Knative build project, so the serverless stack Niklas talked about yesterday. Now it's its own project, which is called Tecton Pipelines, and Tecton is using a completely different approach. So we are still building our containers, our images, and other stuff in containers in a Kubernetes cluster, but Tecton also moves the whole pipeline configuration into our Kubernetes cluster. So we're able to just write YAML, use kubectl apply to push it to our Kubernetes cluster, and use this to define our pipelines. The whole thing is based on custom resource definitions and controllers in the background. It's federated in the Continuous Delivery Foundation project, or as a federated project in the Continuous Delivery Foundation, and it's also used in Jenkins X. So if somebody is using Jenkins X, he's using Tecton under the hood. And there are many contributions from Google, IBM, Red Hat, CloudBees, Trigger Mesh, and some other big players. So it's still a young project, but I think it's evolving over time and time. Which is also important, it's more a framework instead of a tool a user should use. Of course, you can do it, but it's more sought to use it below Jenkins X and below maybe other CI/CD tools in the future. Yeah, so beside the Tecton pipeline project, there's also a Tecton trigger project which you can use to trigger your pipeline. So based on nearly every webhook, if you're doing a push, an issue, any other thing, merge request, and so on, and this one helps you to really automate and trigger your pipelines. And the Tecton project also provides a CLI, so you can also use the Tecton CLI to work with Tecton, but of course, it's just custom resource definitions. You can also just use kubectl apply and the default stuff we all know. And then we have a small dashboard. It's still pretty limited and basic, but at least you have somehow something green if your pipeline finished successfully and something red if you had any kind of issues. Yeah, so pretty new project, but I like it, it's pretty cool. I attached some links to the catalog, which includes some example pipelines where I can just copy-paste and start playing with it, and the link to the tutorial. So once again, let's have a look how this stuff is working. Too many windows. Is it okay? Yeah, perfect. Okay, so as I said, we can just use YAML to define it. First of all, we need a service account. We need this service account because the service account will get the privileges to upload our image to the registry we define. So just create a service account. Then this part is a secret, which basically stores our credentials for the pipeline or for the Docker registry. Which is pretty important is you need to define an annotation which needs to be Docker minus zero and the URL for the internal mapping. And then you have the basics to start with your pipeline definition itself. So then the really Tecton part starts. So we have a kind pipeline resources, which basically defines our resources, so our input and our output. In our case, we once again are building a container image with Kaniko. So we on the input side, we need our Git repo to get our Docker file and our code and stuff. And on the output side, we need to define the registry where the final Docker image needs to be pushed. So it's just a kind pipeline resources. It's pretty nice because later on we will see how we define tasks and pipelines. And then we can define a pipeline run, which then maps our pipeline definitions with our pipeline resource, which allows us to basically use our pipeline definition with every Git repo would like to. So if we have a similar project, which is also building container images, we just need to define a different pipeline resources with a different project, but can reuse our existing pipeline. Which is pretty nice. So we only have one pipeline and just reuse it with different Git repos and pushing to different container registries. Well, that's why the pipeline resource is excluded from different configurations. So then we have the task definition, where we define a name. In this case, it's a build Docker image. We have the option, and this is optional, to define the import resources. I just included it, but we can also define it later on. And then we need to define some parameters where the path to our Docker file and to our context root, and of course define the output resources. In our case, the container registry. This again is optional. We can define it later. And then we have our basically our steps for our image build itself. Once again, we define the Kaneko image. We're providing some environment variables for authentication, and then starting the Kaneko executor with the same arguments as before. So we're defining our Docker file based on the input definitions, destination based on the input output definitions, context root, and caching if we would like to. Yeah, so this is our task. So we now have our repo, our pipeline, our task. And now, in this case, we only have one task because we're only doing one build. If you have multiple tasks, you would need to add multiple ones, and then those combine those in the pipeline definition. So in the pipeline definition, once again, we have our resources. Once again, optional. You can put them in, but you don't need to. And then the list of our tasks. In this case, it's just the task from above. So now we can just do a kube apply. In this case, I already applied it earlier today. And now we have our pipeline definitions. Because of custom resource definitions, we can do stuff like kubectl get pipelines, get our demo pipeline, and then, of course, can also do a describe on the pipeline to get some more information on details about it. So pretty nice. But now we need to execute our pipeline. Well, it's just the definition. Now we have two options. One option is a Tecton trigger project, which is not part of my demo. The other one is to define a pipeline run, that's the name of it, manually. Once again, it's just a small YAML definition, kind pipeline run. And here's where you basically define the input, the output, and the service account, and so forth, the authentication and credentials. So we are here mapping the service account back to the above one for authentication with the Docker registry. We define our pipeline. And this is the final part. We define our input and our output resources, and therefore are able to reuse our pipelines, our tasks, and just customize this one for every other project. So let's have a look at the pods. So we are in default namespace, so we do not have any pods. If you look at the other namespace below, we have Tecton pipeline controller and the webhook controller. And now, when you do a kubectl apply Tecton run, we should see. We should see a new pod, which contains multiple containers, and this is the pod our whole pipeline is scheduled in, and our image is built in. So if we now do a describe pipeline run with a name from our pipeline, we can get some information. Not all steps, tasks have been finished executing, so it's still running. We have the pod name, lots of details. If we get any errors, we will get the in the events below. Now we can also check the logs. and should see our build process. Now the image is gets built with Kaniko, and we get an error. Nice. Okay. Today in the morning it worked. Yeah, okay, it has failed. This is the part where I say Tecton is somehow a platform or not a really tool for end user. Now you need to deep dive into containers and get the logs from the containers and so on. So it's not pretty easy to use. But yeah, so normally we would get a build, not today. And then if the build has been finished, we would have a new container image in our container registry. So the last one is from yesterday ago. Yeah, from 2 days ago. So it somehow worked 2 days ago. The final image as well as the build cache for the layers. Yes, so also pretty nice project to build on. As I said, I wouldn't use it in production at the moment, but hopefully it gets the underlying part of many CI/CD tools in the future, and then it would be nice to define our pipelines on Kubernetes to run everything in Kubernetes and have the same layer in multiple CI/CD tools. So, this was the demo. And I think I'm finished a little bit early. So, I already uploaded slides. The demos are available, so if you'd like to try it out, it's everything available. Any questions? No? Yes? Ah, one. Run.
Doing also some sport, it's okay.
So, as a comparison for this Tecton, if somehow, I don't know, GitLab used it, so if I git push into the GitLab, it would create from, and I had the pipeline definition in my repository, it would then create from my repository a new definition in Kubernetes, and then run everything else with Tecton or something
so
like that?
At the moment, you would need to, if you would like to automate it, but you should, you would need to also install the Tecton trigger project, and then defining the trigger on a webhook from GitLab, a push or something else, and then start run, and just upload the image afterwards in the registry.
This would also really work with Krul with Knative, because you can also set a Knative event hook to the event, and then also triggering a new Tecton pipeline. This would also work. Are there other questions?
Run.
you briefly mentioned that Tecton is part of the Cloud Native Foundation or the CI/CD Foundation they have, right? Do you have an opinion on if this is a good decision? Because Jenkins, for example, is also in that foundation, and there seem to be a lot of, let's say, big players that all do their own thing in the same foundation. So, do you have an opinion on that?
To be honest, I'm not really sure about it. So, Tecton started pretty fast last year, or 2 years ago. I'm not sure when it started. Early last year.
2 years, I think.
2 years. So, it got much attention. Now it's a little bit slowing down, and I think it's because of the CI/CD Foundation, because Jenkins would like to do something, and other ones. So, for me, at least, I still have the hope that at one time, Tecton gets the underlying part of many CI/CD pipelines, and then everyone would do nearly the same, or at least have the same task, and so on. Would be easier for everyone, but We will see.
Other questions? No. So, well, I have also one question. So, how would you handle secrets on your power plants? Because this is an interesting part, but probably because most users need to save securely database passwords or other identities that probably shouldn't be committed into the Git repository, but should be used from the pipeline.
Good question. Yeah, so I'm not sure this is a perfect answer. I'm mainly working in the Azure world, just for use the vault, and build a job, getting the secrets, using the secrets, but also work with HashiCorp, with vault from HashiCorp. So I'm using an external key store most of the time.
Oh, that's true, because what I found out when I used the GitLab variables, the secret variables, it's not about all variables again, it's okay for the first time for prototyping using injecting secrets, but later the problem will be coming when you have not only two passwords or only two secrets, yeah. The versioning will be really, really hard. So then you go the way back and using Git crypt or SOPs or another tool again to crypt your secrets into the repository and then
yeah. So for me it's mostly one secret to authenticate against the vault, yeah. And then just getting the secrets from vault if I need them.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, so then we will make another break, or the last coffee break for the last conference in the next 2 or 3 months. So enjoy your coffee break. Probably we will be back at 4 o'clock, and then we will come to the last talks for the conference. Thanks.